tell me what to do. Oh, I get so angry. I don't know what. Oh, hello. I guess I didn't hear you guys come in. Well, welcome to my carpenter shop. I hope you don't mind if I work while we visit a little bit. I'm kind of behind, and I've got to get this cross built. I suppose you heard me ranting about that Roman soldier. He just drives me crazy. He thinks he's better than everybody else, and he can just tell people what to do. Because I had to work. But this time, this year, we were going to do it right. Yeah. So I thought, until that soldier came this morning. So, you see where I am. And now, I'm breaking a promise again. Well, hopefully, my family will forgive me, but I don't know. They're really embarrassed about what I do. You see, building crosses isn't my normal job. I'm a carpenter by trade. Yeah, I love building things with my hands. It's so rewarding, except for this job. Building crosses. Yep, I do it because that Roman soldier told me I will do it, and I knew what he meant. If I didn't, it would be my head. Well, it's hard to try to explain to people what I do for a living. It's especially hard for me to tell my in-laws. I guess they really want to believe in me, but they find this pretty hard. And you know, quite frankly, it's hard to be proud of what I do. I've embarrassed my son. The other day I overheard him talking to some of his friends. And you know how young boys are. They love to brag about what their dads do for a living. Yeah. Well, when it became my son's turn, I overheard him say, You know, he builds things, necessary things. The poor guy, he didn't have any idea what to say. He was so embarrassed. And frankly, so was I. Not too long ago, I decided that maybe I should attend a crucifixion, you know? To see how something I created was being used. I'll never do that again. To see something that I built with my own hands used to bring such pain and suffering, it was almost more than I could bear.
And they got there, and the place was filled with people.
There wasn't room for anybody else. In fact, there were even people standing around in open doorways and windows so they could see in and they could hear Jesus. Well, all of a sudden, they thought maybe the roof was caving in. There was stuff sifting down from the ceiling. And they wondered what was going on. Well, it turns out there were four men who had brought a friend of theirs who was crippled. And they were carrying him on a mat. And they wanted to get inside to get him in front of Jesus and ask Jesus to heal the friend. But they couldn't get there because of all the people. Oh my. So you know what they did? They went around to a stairway that led to the roof. And they carried their friend clear up on the roof of this house. And then, you're going to love this, they started removing some of the roof tile, making a hole big enough that they could lower their friend on his mat with ropes down in front of Jesus. And so they got this hole made. Can you imagine what Jesus must have thought? But according to my sister, he acted like he didn't even notice until they lowered this man right in front of him. And you know what he said? He told this man, "Son, your sins are forgiven. Take up your mat and go home." Well, now, my sister says that she knew this cripple because her and her friends had met him once before and they had helped him. And so she knew that he was crippled from birth. Okay, it wasn't just some temporary thing because of an accident. He'd been crippled from birth. And when Jesus spoke those words to him, she said, he got up, he took up his mat, and walked right through the crowd. Now, isn't that something? How is it that someone who can heal people is going to be crucified on a cross that I built? I don't understand it. It just doesn't make sense for me. Something else that I heard. There was one of these high-up priest guys, and he actually hired me as a carpenter, you know. It felt pretty good to be given a carpenter job for a change. He had me come to his house, and I was there busy working away. I wasn't trying to eavesdrop or anything, but some of his high priest buddies were there with him. And they started talking. Of course, I could hear what they were saying. He was telling them how there was this man named Lazarus. And Lazarus evidently got really sick. I mean, sick enough to die. And Lazarus had a couple of sisters. And they all knew Jesus. They seemed to be really close friends. And so these sisters sent word to Jesus, telling him that Lazarus was sick, to please come right away. Well, I guess by the time Jesus got there, it was too late. Lazarus was already dead. In fact, my sister said she heard that he'd been dead for 4 days. I'm sure those sisters were pretty upset. Jesus got there and He asked the sisters to take him to the tomb. So they did. And he stopped in front of the tomb. And the priest said that Jesus wept. He must have been really close to this Lazarus person. But then the priest went on to say that Jesus did something really strange. He asked some men that were close by to roll the stone away from the tomb. Yeah, I know what you're thinking. I did too. 4 days? Woo! You can just imagine how bad that was going to stink. Well, Jesus stood in front of that tomb. And he called Lazarus by name and told him to come out. And Lazarus came out. I don't know how that happened. But you know, even though I don't have much use for these high up priests, they are supposed to tell the truth, aren't they? So I reckon it was true. So here, you've got a man who can heal me. And a man who can even raise somebody from the dead. A man who was one day hailed a king. And now today, I'm building this cross. I don't understand. I don't know if any of you can explain that to me, but I'd sure like to understand it. It just doesn't make sense to me. My sister told me one other thing about Jesus. She said he could forgive sins. Wouldn't that be nice? I mean, I've done some things that I sure would like to be forgiven for. Maybe you feel that way too. I just don't understand. How can this be? Thank you.
I wonder. I wonder if maybe Jesus is really who he said he is. But it just doesn't make sense. If that were true, why are they hanging him on a cross? A cross I made with my own hands. And if Jesus could forgive sins, I wonder if he could forgive the cross builder.
Once upon his back he knew this was the beginning of the end. With every fragile step he grew more and more determined to finish it. The world saw a man on his back, and they laughed. But God saw his son, whom he loved, carry more than that. Oh, he didn't just carry the cross, he carried me. So much has been said of what happened at Calvary. Oh, but I believe he didn't just carry the cross, he carried me. Mercy held my broken heart close against his shoulder as he wept. Love beyond the moment scarred the hands and feet of one I've never met. The world saw a man die a martyr. But God saw a lamb bridge the gap of eternity. Oh, he just carried the cross, he carried me. Thank you. monologue that I shared. And he did that several years ago. And about a year after I heard him do the skit, I asked him if he might permit me to borrow that. And he very graciously said, by all means, do with it whatever you choose to make it yours. Do you remember the last words that Jesus spoke from the cross? I'm sure you do. It is finished. Well, of course, Jesus wasn't speaking in English. The Greek word that he used was the word tetelestai. And that meant it is finished. But it also meant paid in full. And it was very often used and was written across a certificate of debt when someone had finally paid off a debt they owed, money that they had borrowed. Tetelestai, paid in full. Is that not what Jesus did for you?
Amen.
Amen.
He purchased our complete freedom. But he didn't stop there. He rose from the dead. And we need to relate to Jesus both dying on the cross for our sins and being raised from the dead, so that we might also have resurrection power, the power of God's Holy Spirit dwelling within our own being, so that we will have everything we need to live in righteousness and holiness. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15, I know you said last evening that was probably one of your favorite chapters in the Bible. And Paul said there, but thanks be to God, he gives us the victory.
Amen.
Through our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Whose victory was it? It was his victory. It wasn't ours.
Amen.
It was his, and he graciously gave us his victory.
Amen.
Not because we deserved it, but because we desperately need it.
Amen.
I would like to invite you to do a very Quakerly thing here, since I'm a Friends pastor. I'd like for us to enter into just a brief, quiet time of spiritual communion, where I invite you to do one thing and one thing only. Listen.